Welcome to the Teacher's Corner for the Curriculum Projects. The projects in this video are based on the Alberta Elementary School curriculum, but should be appropriate for students anywhere. Keep in mind that everything must be as thick as a finger. On the L-shaped dioramas, sometimes the folded area is weak. Applying a coil to the inside of the fold will give it needed support. Give each student the freedom at the end of the workshop to add their own personal touches with things that are relevant to their studies.
For this project, we'll need the extra large ball of clay, the medium ball of clay, and then clay handed out as needed. We want to take our little messy ball of clay and turn it into a slab. The first thing we have to do with our little messy ball of clay is rule number one. We're going to have fun with this. We're going to take our messy ball of clay, put it on the table with our hand open, big and flat. We're going to roll it on the table around and around and around. Some people will have problem moving your hand around and around and around. Then you can use your hands and work together to smooth it out. That's one of the guidelines. So we're going to move it around and around on the table using your hand till it goes from a messy ball of clay to a nice tidy ball of clay. Doesn't have to be perfectly round like a baseball, just tidy. After it's tidy, we're going to put it on the paper. Roll on the table, put it on the paper, then we're going to make a fist. Now no one here has a hammer or a pounder or a banger or a smasher. All those things come out of your whole shoulder. And we're all strong enough to take our fist and go, bam, right in the middle of that and wreck it. Then we'd have to squish it up and we'd have to start over with rule number two, and that would just affect rule number one. So what we're going to do is we're going to make a tapper. And the tappers come out of your elbow. Sometimes it's a firm tap, like a jack tapper, but we're going to gently tap this clay and we're going to tap it into a pancake or a slab. There's just three wee taps and already my ball of clay is flattening out into a pancake. So I'm going to tap and turn and tap and turn, starting from one side, a little bit in, tapping across, and ending before the other side. And then a little bit in, tap and turn, and see how it flattens out into a pancake. You can flatten it out with your hand, you can make it tidy. I'm going to tap and turn and tap and turn. Now we have a pancake that's about 15 centimeters wide, or about 6 inches. But what's more important is your pancake is as thick as your finger. If you put it beside, they are the same. We don't have any little tiny skinny flat fingers. We don't have any little tiny skinny flat pancakes. So we've tapped this, we've been it nice and flat and tidy with our hands. We're gonna turn over our paper and turn over our pancake. We have this lovely smooth surface waiting to be made into anything. We're going to build an Inuit diorama. The first thing we're going to do is to make sure your name is on the bottom of your pancake, and then we want to stand it up and make it into a diorama, or has dimension. We're going to bend it in the middle and stand it up, support at the back and push at the front to make sure where they meet is nice and firm, and you have a nice flat bottom and a nice flat back to build your diorama on. So the next thing we're going to do is we want to build an Inuit diorama. We can go either with a igloo or a nunchuck. We're going to build the igloo first. A ball of clay, rolling it on the table. Now this ball of clay is going to be the whole igloo, and I want to put it on here, but I have to make sure that it's flat on the bottom so it joins, and flat on the back. So this has the same right angle that our diorama has. So we're going to put it on here, and I'm not going to wet and wiggle and twist and stick because I'm going to take this off when I'm finished and show you how to make it a nunchuck. So we're going to pretend to wet and wiggle. If I were going to join this on, I would wet this piece where it touches the clay, and I'd wet this piece. And I'd wiggle it into that right angle and make it nice and firm. So we're going to pretend that we did that. And now I'm going to make the little igloo a tunnel, or where the little fellow crawls into. And I have a nice little cylinder. But I want to make a little cave in there, a little hole. So I'm just going to gently, with my finger, put it in there. Spin it around a bit. It's messy on the top, like a messy pinch pot. Same method, tap it so it's tidy. And then now we have our little igloo. I want a flat back to join that on. Wet and wiggle, twist and stick, and blend it in. And now I want to decorate it like an igloo. So igloos are made with circles of ice. So we're going to start with a circle on the top and a circle in the middle. And we're going to build it ice block by ice block with our toothpick. Another circle for our ice blocks to go on. We're going to stagger our ice blocks because that's how the igloos are built. We're going to do some ice blocks on our tunnel. I'm going to turn it a bit and see some more ice blocks. Staggering our ice blocks. And lastly, at the bottom, we have our stack of ice. So now our little Inuit person has a wonderful little igloo to live in. So we could make it an igloo project or an inukchuk. Right now our igloo is just going to sit over there and wait to be an igloo. So we're going to build an inukchuk. An inukchuk is made out of rocks, great big piles of rocks. So we want to roll out our coil, keeping in mind that this is a great big rock for our inukchuk. So we don't want any little tiny flat skinny rocks. We have to make sure they're nice, round, thick rocks, so they look like an inukchuk. We're going to build his legs. I want his legs to stick. Notice I do on the bottom as well as the back, wet and wiggle. Now his legs don't have to be the same size, because rocks are never the same size. You can build them the way you like, a little bit bigger, a little bit smaller. There's the first part of the inukchuk. We're going to give his body. If the coil for the body is as big as your finger, it can stick out past the edge. We don't want any little pieces of clay. We all know little pieces of clay break. So now we're going to build the body. Wet and wiggle. And you can make two or three body parts on there. He's your inukchuk, or she. We're going to do the big rock for the arms. Again, I have nice fat coils so they can stick out past. And I'm going to give our inukchuk a head. We're going to roll it and flatten it gently. But again, it's a rock, so make sure your rocks are nice and thick. They're as thick as your finger. That way, when his head sticks over the top, it won't break off. Inukchuks also don't have a face, so we don't want to give this guy a face. Now, another part of the north is the midnight sun. So we're going to build a midnight sun. Now you can build your midnight sun as big or as little, within reason, as you like. To build the sun, we're going to roll the ball on the table. We're going to flatten it on the paper, and I'm going to decorate the sun before I put it on my project. I'm going to decorate with the side of the toothpick, via resting toothpick designs. If you decorate with your toothpick standing up, what will happen is a standing up toothpick will cut the clay and it'll ruin it. So what you want to do is resting toothpicks is gently just press the toothpick into the clay, making toothpick marks, but not actually cutting or hurting your clay. So we're going to do our toothpick marks before we put the sun on. You can do long ones and short ones. You can do combinations of sun prints, but now we have the midnight sun, and again it's as thick as a cookie, so we're going to attach it to our diorama and it can stand up over the top. Okay, this is the first stage. We're going to get to this stage. You're going to make your igloo or your inukchuk, your midnight sun, And when everyone gets to this stage, we're going to come back and we're going to make our little Inuit person. Now we want to build a little Inuit person to stand in the front of our diorama. What we're going to do is, again, we're going to start with a ball of clay, nip it off with our fingertips, and we're going to roll out a cylinder. Now we don't want any little tiny skinny people. So we don't want any cylinders, little skinny cylinders. You want your cylinder to be about as big as two thumbs. So now we have our cylinder, and we're going to give our guy a head. So we're going to again roll a ball of clay, and pay attention, if you've got a body this big, you're not going to put that on there for a head, because all his friends would laugh at him. And again, you're not going to put on a ball of clay like this for his head, because it's just way too big. So if it looks too small, it's too small. If it looks too big, well, it's too big. So we're going to roll off a little ball of clay, put it on so it looks about the right size. Make it tidy, and now our little guy's got a head on. We don't want his head to fall off, so we're going to wet and wiggle and twist and stick his head. And we're going to make the parka. Now, this person in this parka can be anybody. When someone in the north puts on a great big coat, all you see is a coat and a person inside. So if you want your person in the parka to be a girl, she's a girl. If you want your person in the parka to be a boy, well then, he's a boy. So to make the parka, we're going to roll out a ball of clay. Again, make it nice and big. We don't want any skinny little parka hoods. We're going to make a nice big ball of fur to go around that face. Wet and wiggle. Gonna put it on there and make sure it fits. So now you can see the parka forming, and make sure the parka goes around his face. Sometimes parkas sort of go around the back, looking at the northern lights. So make sure it goes around his face and under his or her chin. Now before we go any further, we have to make sure that all these parts are gonna stay on. So what I'm going to do with my thumb is dry. I'm going to blend or smear that in the back so his head is attached to the parka. And again, blend and smear that fur collar so it's all attached together. So it even looks from the back like he's wearing a parka or a big hood. Now with my toothpick, I'm going to texture this. I'm going to put on some fur, just again with the side of the toothpick, slowly and gently going around, making the big fur collar. With the big fur, gently with the toothpick going around and around, we're going to frame his face with the fur. We're going to give this person a toothpick face. You can give them a toothpick face, or you can give them a sideways toothpick face. So the side of your toothpick, we're just going to give them some eyes and a nose and a mouth. And you can usually see a little bit of hair sticking out. So now we have our person, but our person doesn't have any arms. So we're going to give our person some arms. Again, roll out a coil, twice as long as I want it to be, but the same size. Fold it in half. I have two arms the same size. Now think about it, when you look at a person, when they stand up straight and put their hands straight down, nobody can scratch their ankles. So make sure when you put your arms on that they're not really far down. See, these guys are kind of far down. So your arms only go to about your hips. So this is the length I like. Put it on here, measure. Now we have two arms the same size. Tap them tidy. Wet and wiggle. And now he's got arms. Gonna give him some fur around the sleeves of his coat or his parka. Roll out a little skinny piece of clay. And wet and wiggle his arms, put the fur on, and with the side of the toothpick, just like you made the fur around the face, we're going to put fur around his sleeves. I'm going to do the other side. Wet and wiggle, make sure it's nice and wet and it sticks. When you're doing this, make sure your clay is really soft. If you try to do this with clay that's dried out for a while, it'll crack and fall off and be really hard to work with. So when you're doing the fur around his sleeves, make sure you're working with nice, soft, fresh clay. Okay, so now he has his arms. But he's standing with his arms straight out. Nobody walks around with their arms straight out. So let's just bend them down to his sides. And take a minute at the back and blend those arms in to make sure his arms don't fall off. You have to blend or smear all the pieces together. So now we have our Inuit person ready to be put on the pancake. You don't put them on until they're completely finished building. It's too hard to build this person when it's stuck to the pancake. Wet and wiggle, and we can wet and wiggle and wiggle and wiggle and wiggle and make sure there's lots of glue to glue down that Inuit person. You can put him on the pancake where you like. So there he is with the nukchuck, the midnight sun, and this person with his big parka. Now again, you can do this with the igloo where the nukchuck is. Here's our Inuit diorama. And now when we all get to this stage, we're going to come back for our project check. Okay, now we're going to do our project check, and I'm going to look at him, and I realize that I want to do a bit more fur on his collar. I want it to go around the back a bit more. And also looking at him, I didn't put a zipper on his coat. Kind of looks like his coat comes all the way down to the ground. I think a bit more fur on his sleeves. And everything is wet and wiggled and twisted and stuck. I think he's ready for drying. When clay is wet, it has water in it. What happens to the clay when it dries and all the water goes away? Clay shrinks when it dries. If it dries quickly or unevenly, it can crack or even break. When the projects have been completed, place them all together on a flat surface. Larger pieces need some special attention. They need to be compressed or compacted to hold them together. You want to just squeeze the body and squish them together. If they aren't compressed or compacted, they will break. When they do break and they're still wet, you can just simply put them back together by wet and wiggle, score and twist and stick. Now you want to lightly cover the projects with a plastic sheet or garbage bag overnight to allow them to equalize. This just means the moisture content in the big and the little pieces reaches the same level. The next morning when you uncover them, do a quick project check and fix any problems that might have shown up overnight. This mask is firm enough I can take the paper out. You want to make sure his eyes are loose at the back, are not going to fall out. You can smooth him out if he's a bit messy. As long as the clay is even just a little bit wet, you can repair most problems. Leave the projects uncovered for about 4 hours and then cover them again through the second night. After that, they can be left open to dry completely. Before you paint, you want to make sure your clay is dry. It will change color from dark to light. When the project has turned color all over, it's time to paint. If you're unsure, it's better to take an extra day or two for drying than to let them dry too quickly. Drying times will vary. Now the projects are dry, you can use one of two finishing methods: painting the air dry clay or firing it in a kiln. All the projects in this series can be air dried, so let's see how we can paint them. We suggest painting be a team activity with the students working in pairs.
For the initial paint applications, one student can hold a project so its bottom's facing up, and the other student can apply paint. The paint dries rapidly, so the student can hold the project for a few minutes before setting it down on the paper. Apply two coats of paint to the bottom and up the sides a bit and allow it to dry. Once all the bottoms are done, the students can work on their own. Now that the bottom is dry, turn the project over, and with the dry bottom side down, apply two coats to the top. The acrylic paint will soak into the clay. It's better to use more paint than less. The best paint for this type of project, believe it or not, is the cheapest type you can buy, usually at a big box or discount store. The reason is these cheaper paints are already thinned, and they go much further than the expensive paints. Choose one color to paint the entire project, and when it's dry, you can decorate and accent with different colors. For example, when painting a caterpillar, paint the entire piece green, and then add colored trim. All surfaces must be generously covered. Now, if a piece of the sculpture should come loose, as has happened with the caterpillar's little foot here, there are at least two ways of reattaching it. If it's a flat piece, you can use paint as glue. Put a blob between the pieces and stick. If the pieces are not flat, paint both surfaces, allow them to dry, then glue gun them together. After the glue sets, paint again. Glue will stick to painted surfaces, but not to the bare clay surface. Now we've painted our caterpillar with two generous coats of acrylic paint all in one color, and the real fun can start now. This is where you begin to make the project really your own. You can take a contrasting color, like the yellow that Cindy's using here, you can paint his eyes, you can paint on his spikes, for instance. The big thing is to use your imagination. There's nothing that says more, "This is my caterpillar," than what you do with the paint.
We can paint his toes.
Could paint his toes. Not red. Oh, we're painting them brown, so he's going to have brown toes.
It's a him, so we're not going to paint his toes red.
Okay.
We can paint his toes brown. You can add a little bit to your leaf. Thin colors. If you brush it on thin, it has a bit of a different color. Make your stem a different color. I'm going to paint his toes over here brown.
So you get the idea. If you've got several different colors, just remember that sometimes less is better than more. You can go crazy with decorating and then you wind up with a really funny looking caterpillar. But it is your project. The biggest thing is to remember rule number one and have fun.
There, now he'll look at you.
When the paint is dry, you should spray the projects with a low odor clear gloss sealant. Now, it's better to have an adult spray seal the projects after the students have finished painting them and the paint is dried. We suggest you cover a table with paper and seal all of the projects at the same time. As we said, the sealant should be low odor, meaning it does have a bit of an odor. However, it's not harsh at all, and it will dissipate quickly. When applying the sealant, as with the paint, seal the bottom first by turning over the project and spraying. Try to place the project so only the bottom is sprayed, and the sealant cannot stick to the paper. Allow the bottom to completely dry for a minimum of at least 1 hour. Elevate the project on something smaller than the diameter of the bottom, for example, coins or broken pieces of a wooden craft stick, and spray, trying not to let the project touch the paper. Once the project is completely sealed, allow it to dry overnight. The projects actually toughen up over the next 2 or 3 days. If the sealant sticks to the paper and removes some paint revealing the clay, and this will happen from time to time, simply reapply the paint to the spot and spot seal it again. The projects are now finished and can be sent home.
The projects are sturdy and can be washed with a damp cloth and should provide years of memories.